Isaac and his mother lived alone in a small house on a hill. Isaac kept to himself, drawing pictures and playing with his toys as his mom watched Christian broadcasts on the television. Life was simple, and they were both happy. That was until the day Isaac's mom heard a voice from above. Your son has become corrupted by sin. He needs to be saved. I will do my best to save him, my lord, Isaac's mother replied, rushing into Isaac's room, removing all that was evil from his life. Again, the voice called to her. Isaac's soul is still corrupt. He needs to be cut off from all that is evil in this world and confess his sins. I will follow your instructions, Lord. I have faith in thee, Isaac's mother replied, as she locked Isaac in his room, away from the evils of the world. One last time, Isaac's mom heard the voice of God calling to her. You've done as I've asked, but I still question your devotion to me. To prove your faith, I will ask one more thing of you. Yes, Lord, anything, Isaac's mother begged. To prove your love and devotion, I require a sacrifice. Your son, Isaac, will be this sacrifice. Go into his room and end his life as an offering to me to prove you love me above all else. Yes, Lord, she replied, grabbing a butcher's knife from the kitchen. Isaac, watching through a crack in his door, trembled in fear. Scrambling around his room to find a hiding place, he noticed a trap door to the basement hidden under his rug. Without hesitation, he flung open the hatch, just as his mother burst through his door and threw himself down into the unknown depths below.
Well, if that intro didn't get you pumped to play this game, then I'm not sure what will. Hello everyone, this is ArgonMatrix, welcoming you to episode 1 of The Binding of Isaac Rebirth, the newest Let's Play on my channel, one that's probably going to be continuing for a while to come in the future. Before I get into any of this, I'm going to address something that some of you might be concerned about. Wind Waker and Secret of Mana are not going anywhere. I'm kind of burnt out, as you might be able to tell by the very, very infrequent uploads on this channel. And I think the best way to unburn myself out, if that's even proper terminology, which it totally isn't, is to just start a new game that I'm really into and do a Let's Play of that for a little while, and then get back into Wind Waker and Secret of Mana as the timing feels right. And the perfect game, in my opinion, is this one right here, because I have just been so in love with this game from the day it came out. I've been in love with this game from before the day it came out, honestly, because I played the hell out of the original, The Binding of Isaac. And the reason I'm not actually playing that, the original before this one is that this one's just an improved version of that one in every way imaginable. It's identical to it and then upgraded. That's basically the best way I can put it. It's less of a sequel, more of an upgrade. There's all the settings, I'm not going to really change anything there. I just wanted to kind of show off what you can change if you're interested. So, this is going to be a lot of hullabaloo before I actually get into any gameplay, just to let you know, but before I do anything, I should let you know that, in contrast to pretty much every game I've played on my channel up to this point, this one has kind of a lot of mature-er content. Not that I guess I'm saying shit and fuck all the time anyway, so who cares? But if you're grossed out by poop or fart humor or, like, blood or gore or anything like that, then this might not be the game for you to watch, so just a forewarning there. But for anyone else, basically, what this is, if you're not familiar with The Binding of Isaac, it's a roguelike game, which means that everything is randomly generated every time you play, giving it effectively infinite replayability. I'm going to set the game to hard mode here really quick. And we can't play as any of these other characters because we don't have the criteria unlocked for them yet. You can kind of see what you have to do in order to unlock each one. So we're just going to start as Isaac, since we don't have much of an option. Alright. So yeah, everything from the room layout, to the items you'll get, to the enemies you'll face, it's all completely randomized. Of according to this seed right here in the top left there, SB80 FT4X. That'll be in the description, and you can input that if you want to play along. So yeah, let's just get right into it here. Basically, it's kind of like Zelda, and it's a top-down scroller. That is a great first item, Luckfoot. Increases our luck stat, and luck will be very... It's kind of an invisible stat in this game, but it's very handy. That's a great second item! Okay. This is a curse room, by the way. It's basically, you could see I took damage when I walked in, and you'll take damage when you walk out, too, so you have to keep that in mind. Gimpy makes it so that every time, well, sometimes, occasionally when you get hit, you'll drop a spirit heart. What is a spirit heart? We'll get that to that in a second. Gosh, there's so much to go over in this game. I didn't even really consider that. There's, like, really just so many layers to this game. It's going to take a long time to get used to it if you're completely new to the franchise. If you played the original, then you have a general idea of what's going on. And I highly, highly recommend picking up, maybe not the original at this point, maybe just jump right into Rebirth here. Actually, I'm going to head down here. I wanted to head back there just for a reason we'll see in a second here. But yeah, this one's just so much more improved in every way than the original that there's not much of a reason to go back and play that one except for nostalgia's sake or if you want to see how things are improved. Anyway. So yeah, you can shoot these poops here. You might not always want to shoot the poops. Sometimes you can use them for cover from enemy fire and stuff. But in general, you're going to want to shoot them to see if you can get them to drop consumables. Mostly money, as you can see over here. There we go. Alright, and this down here is that's a locked door. We don't have a key to open it just yet. But we might pick one up if we shoot enough poops. I don't even actually remember if poops can drop keys or not. For some reason, I feel like they can't. Alright, and you might be looking at this and like, how the heck are you supposed to get to that chest in the middle there? Well, if you notice, on our left-hand side of our screen, we have bombs as consumables here, so we can drop a bomb and blow up some rocks. Oh yeah. And that is a pill. When you get one, you won't know what it does. You can see question marks down in the corner there, but if you use it with Q, then you'll see what it does. Bad trip basically just hurts you for a heart damage, which sucks. I'm actually going to put a bomb right here to check for something really quick. That is where our secret room is. And that is a great item. Lost contact, shielded tears, basically means that if our tears come into contact with enemy shots, then they'll explode on impact, both ours and the enemy shots, so it can protect us and hinder us in certain circumstances. As I was saying, though, you might be wondering how I knew to bomb right there to find a secret room. Basically, if you look on the map in the top right corner, any room that's surrounded on at least three sides by other rooms, or any blank space that's surrounded on three sides by other rooms, is likely to contain a spirit room, or a secret room, or more likely than most. There are also actually on every floor a super secret room, which will be surrounded only on one side by a room. So those are a little bit trickier to come across, but not impossible. Another thing about super secret rooms is that they tend to be closer to boss rooms, which, yeah, there's bosses in this game, oh boy. I can't wait. So the bosses are actually some of my favorite parts of this game. To be honest, they're so creative and so hard, a lot of them. Like, they get frustrating, but you fall in love with them. They seem to develop kind of personalities if you play enough of the game. Like, you come across a certain boss and you're like, ah, this guy again. He's the guy stealing my cable. Man, what an asshole. Ooh, God. Alright, there's a key. We could actually head to the shop now. I normally don't recommend heading to the shop unless you have at least 15 cents, because that's the amount normally an item will cost from the shop, like this battery here, which stores energy. That'll come into play later. And there's a donation machine up here. You can donate money. And over the course of every run you do, the money in this will stay constant. So on the next run I do, if I don't donate any more than this, it'll still have 1 cent in it. And if you're strapped for money on a run, then you can bomb the donation machine to get some money out of that. But the main purpose of it is to unlock items throughout the course of the game. So another new, not new feature, but another notable feature, is you can see this rock just below me is kind of different from the other ones. It's got a little X on it and has a blue hue to it. So that's a tinted rock right there. And if you bomb it, more often than not, they'll drop spirit hearts like that. And that's what spirit hearts are, by the way, is basically... They're hearts, just like your red hearts, but if you lose them, you cannot refill them, as you can a red heart container. So our first boss is going to be Gurglings, which is actually kind of annoying. They don't do much. Like, they just charge at you and they leave these little glowing red trails called creep that will damage you if you walk over them, so be mindful of that. But honestly, I'm feeling in a pretty good spot right now. Based on, I haven't really talked about it much, but I've gotten pretty good luck for how I've been doing so far. And not just because Luckfoot was my first item. That, I mean, that could be part of it, I guess, because that increases, I think, consumable drops. It, there's a lot of stuff that it affects. We'll have to go into it over the course of several videos, I know. Unfortunately, our shielded tiers aren't going to be doing too much here. Another effect that I think shielded tiers have, though, is you can see, like, there's the circle around them. That's the shield around the tiers, obviously. But, ooh, the pentagram, that's really good. It's basically just a straight damage upgrade, which is, and it's one of the best straight damage upgrades in the entire game. In between every level, we'll get these little vignettes of, just Isaac. It's kind of neat. I'll end up probably skipping those eventually, because there's not a huge selection of them. They repeat eventually. Basement 2, here we go. There's another tinted rock down there, you can notice. It might be hard to notice them if you're a total newbie to the game, but once you play enough of it, you get a kind of a sixth sense for them, almost. These guys aren't so bad. Yeah, but I've actually been getting pretty lucky, because I went to that curse room and there was an item in it, and I went to that secret room and there's an item in it. That is not... That is the 1%, as they say. Not all curse rooms will contain items. In fact, most of them won't. This, by the way, is a sacrifice room. You can hurt yourself on this spike for the chance for a chest to drop. If you get knocked down to half a red heart by this thing, a chest will always drop. I generally don't find this to be worth it, but they could have their uses in the future. You never know what will happen on any given run. I'm going to bomb right here to get that tinted rock. And as the levels actually progress, tinted rocks will become progressively harder to notice. In the basement here, they're not too bad, but once we get down to the second chapter, quote-unquote, you'll start to see. So you may also be noticing some enemies, like these guys, these Christmas-colored dudes, red and green here. They're different from the enemies, and more of these will spawn on hard mode. These are called champion enemies. And basically the difference with them is that they have roughly twice as much HP as their regular colored counterparts. And they each have certain attributes to them. Like the green one there, you can see he was dropping green creep. This is a pretty bad item, all things considered, actually, but shoop de whoop. He gives us a spacebar item, which I haven't been able to talk about yet. But before I talk about that, I'll finish about my diatribe about champions here. Basically, there's harder versions of normal enemies. They have certain attributes to them. Some of them will explode. Some of them will explode into bullets. Some of them will go fast, like that gold guy there. And then, yeah. My cat is kind of freaking out at me right now, so pardon that. I don't know if you can hear that in the background. So, yeah, spacebar items, like Shoop de Whoop here. Basically, hit space and you can use them. That's what Shoop de Whoop does. It doesn't do a ton of damage, but it's kind of worth it. And you can see how the little bar next to Shoop de Whoop up there is divided into two segments. That means it is a two-room charge. So once I complete two rooms after having used it one time, it will recharge. And actually, an item we picked up earlier, Two of Clubs, is a consumable playing card. Sorry for just interrupting myself, like, point blank there, but if we use this, it'll double the amount of bombs we currently have, which is pretty good. If you don't have any bombs, it'll just give you two bombs straight up. But yeah, that item that we picked up earlier in the first shop, the battery, that'll make it so that we can actually charge past the point of maximum charge, but only to the... We can only double charge our item, so we can get effectively two uses of Shoop de Whoop on one room if we want to. Which is, makes Shoop de Whoop actually a little bit better than you might expect. Alright, I'm actually going to put a bomb up here for the hope that I'll find a secret room and also to get that key. No secret room, but the key is nice. And I'm highly confident that the secret room will actually be here instead. There we go. And this is actually kind of interesting to show off because if you don't have a key to get into the shop, but your secret room is adjacent to a shop or treasure room, as you can see, we had to... On the first floor, we didn't have to unlock our treasure room, but on this floor, we did, if you noticed. And, I'm just going to donate my money to this donation machine. you're really going to want to rack this thing up over the course of a lot of runs, because you have to get it up to 999 coins to max out everything, so be prepared for a long haul with that bad boy. Alright, just got to be careful here. And we got Dingle, which, according to a lot of people, is probably one of the harder bosses you can face in the first few floors here. Thanks to shielded tiers, actually, he's not as bad. But his worst attack doesn't even involve him shooting bullets. I don't even know if he'll get the chance to show it off before we... Oh yeah, he will. There's his little charge attack. A pretty good strategy, I find, if there's poops in the room like there are here, is you can actually hide behind those poops when he charges, and he can't really fit behind there, because he's too much of a fat little turd. So, there we go. Monstrous Tooth has appeared in the basement. I'm not sure what unlocked that, but there we go. Old Bandage. By the way, Monstrous Tooth is just an item you can pick up later if we need to. So, this is something interesting, and you'll be seeing this a lot over the course of this LP. This just opened up after we beat the boss there. It is a deal with the devil. And what that is there's a lot to deal with the devils. Basically, it's what you can see here. You can trade your HP permanently, so I'll get rid of one heart, and I'll be down to 3 red hearts total, and I'll get this item. So, it's a literal deal with the devil. You're selling your life to Satan here, in order to hopefully benefit yourself. And I'm actually going to... this is actually really interesting. I'm going to pick up this, which is Guppy's Head, a reusable fly hive. When you use it, it spawns attack flies, which will attack enemies for you at a rate of, I think, 1.5 times your tier damage. And I'm going to pick up this, Dead Cat, which will automatically knock you down to 1 red heart, no matter how many you had. But it will give you 9 chances to die, so I can die and come back 9 times. Just like a cat. Like my little cat Guppy. Aww. Anyways, let's head down to the next floor. Basically what determines it, by the way, if you get a deal with the devil after a boss, is if you take red heart damage on the floor. Like, if I... Since I have 3 spirit hearts here, I'm feeling fairly confident that I can get some deals with the devil. These are black hearts, by the way. I unlocked Lazarus. I think that's for having 4 spirit hearts / black hearts on one run. So that's cool. New character to play as next time, maybe. Another pill. Luck up. That's pretty good, actually. If Luckfoot wasn't enough. Yeah, so if you take spirit heart damage or black heart damage, then it won't affect your deal with the devil chances. But if you take red heart damage, it will. You'll still have a pretty good chance to get a deal with the devil after the boss if you take red heart damage on the rooms preceding the boss fight. You won't have... It'll be less than 100%. Crap, that was really bad, actually. But what really hinders your chances is if you take red heart damage on the actual boss fight itself, so take care not to do that if you ever have the opportunity. This guy's gonna explode. He's a dark green champion, so you want to stay away from him when you try to kill him. I should be using Guppy's Head at pretty much every chance I get here. It's a one-room charge, so why the hell not, right? Okay, and I generally don't go for these chests. I still don't think it's worth it, because those spikes do 1 heart of damage, not just half a heart like pretty much everything else. Crack the Sky is a new item. It's not very good. It's a 4-room charge, and totally not worth it. All those beams of light will do a little bit of damage to enemies in the room. I'm going to keep Guppy's Head, if you don't mind. Thank you and good day, sir. It's in here. That's a new item, but I can't buy it because I don't have the money. That's going to be a common problem in this game, I think. Let's just do that. A blue map. That's another new item that we can buy in the shop if we ever get the chance. There we go. Racking up some good amount on our donation machine there. Let me check really quick here for a secret room. Oh, yeah. Oh, my gosh. And that actually does give me enough money to go buy that item in the shop. And that was a really good item in combination with Guppy's Head here. You could call it a synergy, if you're so inclined. Hive Mind makes your attack flies and attack spiders that we'll get into later. They make them bigger, and I think they make them do more damage as a result of being bigger. So that's pretty cool. Okay. So I feel like I was on a tangent about something and then I totally forgot, which is bound to happen a lot in these videos, mind you. The world, I believe, that lets us see the entire floor, including where the secret room is, think I'm going to save that for the next floor, because we've already uncovered a fair amount of this floor on our own. Alright, come on. There we go. Jeez, man. Have I found the treasure room on this floor? You can hold tab, by the way, to bring up the map like that. It also tells you what floor you're on, the caves one, and gives you your time, which is for more than just tracking your speedrunning potential. I'm going to do this. This is a enemy arena, or mob arena. That's kind of... that can be good or bad, depending on your outlook on life. Yeah, but basically it taunts you with chests or an item in the middle of the room, and if you decide to pick it up or open the chest, then you'll have to fight three waves of enemies. And there are actually certain, like, variations of this room that have a skull over the door. That's how you'll be able to tell the difference. You can only get into those rooms if you have one heart or less, one red heart or less, I should say. Spirit hearts don't count. And in those rooms, you'll fight 2 to 3 boss enemies, which is pretty gnarly, depending on your state, but some items can definitely be worth it. Or some chests, as a matter of fact. Alright, and if this guy would just die, shielded tears are being kind of a detriment against those guys, actually. Lots of red hearts on the ground here, holy cow. Alright, looking pretty good. This is actually a stellar first run, if I'm being completely honest with you. Like, the game will not be this kind to me over the course. Like, I'm gonna probably lose more than 50% of my runs. I'm not exceptionally good at this game. I just play it a lot, and that's why I've accomplished some of the things that I have. Which, if you've been following me on Twitter, then you'll actually know some of the things. Sorry for skipping that boss intro, by the way. This is Mega Maw. He's kinda interesting. And I swear, the first time I saw his name, I thought it said Mega Man. But then I was like, Mega Man, that doesn't make any sense. Aw, he's just a Mega Maw. Oh, okay. Oh, I didn't actually realize that the shield of tears would block the fires coming out of Mega Maw. That is pretty handy. Those enemies, by the way, when they're lit on fire and charred black like that, are a lot, well, not a lot more dangerous, a little bit more dangerous. Oh yeah, I remember something I wanted to say, just so much to say. Don't worry, once we get over past the first few videos, we'll start to get over... I think people will start to get a handle on the mechanics of this game. If you haven't already, I might be over-explaining things. This is a really good item. Growth hormones, speed and damage up. What it says on the tin. Another deal with the devil. And I think, even though it's going to take away all my red hearts, I'm going to take this. I unlocked Azazel. That's for taking, was it 2 or 3 deal with the devils on one run? So, that was ceremonial robes, and in addition to making us look like fucking badass Emperor Palpatine over here, look at me! I'm crazy! It gives us a notable damage upgrade, and it also gives us 3 black hearts, I believe. Black hearts, by the way, since I didn't talk about them at all, I've just kind of been babbling on about them in the hopes that you know what's going on. But what they do is when you lose one, it will do a little bit of damage to, actually a lot of it of damage to every enemy in the room. So this is what I was talking about earlier. This is a boss trap room, and I think I'll actually take this one on. That is a new item, but not a very good one. Bob's Rotten Head. The Parasite has appeared. That's interesting. Not sure what I did there. But this one is basically a tossable poisonous bomb. And this is a boss we have not actually come across yet in the proper boss room. We will, though, don't you worry. We'll have plenty of time to face all these bosses in their own personal limelights, don't you worry. And I'm sure all of them will kill us at least once in certain circumstances. Especially this guy. I'm not good at fighting him at all. He starts off fairly tame here. Especially with shielded tears, now that I think about it, he'll be pretty easy. But once we get into his later stages, which, spoiler alert, I guess, but... Alright, and that was a pretty bad golden chest, all things considered. A general rule of thumb is that golden chests should contain better outcomes than regular iron chests. And then there are two different kinds of other chests that we've... Have we come across them yet? I'm not even sure. I'll talk about them the next time I see them, I guess. Don't want to get too flustered now. Alright. And a penny for our troubles. Penny for your thoughts, my dear. And actually, let me use the world there, and that covers our entire map, just like I promised you. You didn't think I was lying, did you? Alright, those orange fires, by the way, you can see it was kind of a different tint from the regular fires we've been facing. That will shoot bullets at you if you leave it for long enough, so better take care of it earlier sooner rather than later. And I was saying something else, and I got sidetracked again. Can you believe it? Okay, let's see what this card is first and foremost. There's my cat again in the background. The stars will teleport us to the treasure room, which I wonder where it could be. Do you guys see it? On the left? Yay! Good job, everyone! That's you, the bean. Toot on command. Basically, you fart, and you poison enemies that are nearby. In certain circumstances, it can be invaluable, as I've found on certain runs, but most of the time, not. So this guy, you can give him your keys, and depending on how many you give him, he'll pay out with certain different things. We only have one key to spare, so I'm just gonna blow him up. Well, I was gonna blow him up, but then I realized I don't have any bombs, so the point is kind of moot, isn't it? So now I'm gonna have to head all the way around here. And normally I am kind of a completionist and I like to go to all the rooms on the floor, but for the purposes of video, I think I'm going to try to kill that instinct as much as I can, unless I absolutely have to. Like, if I'm liable to lose a run if I don't go to every room, then I'll obviously explore every room for the best chance to win, because what do you want in a game is to win, right? I wanna win, Jimmy! That's not a reference to anything, that's just me being weird. Could be a reference to something and I just wouldn't even know it. But I'm feeling fairly confident on this run, or confident enough on this run, that I don't need to go to every single room. I will go to this room, though, because it could be something great. This is perfect. The other two kind of chests that I wanted to talk about. Red chests can contain good items, like those attack flies we just got out of it. Or they could contain bad items, like those attack flies. No, sometimes they can contain like bombs that'll explode on you. They can contain spiders, all sorts of stuff. And this is a stone chest here. You gotta have a bomb to open that one. And I think they generally have the same payouts or similar payouts as golden chests, which can be items like infamy here, which occasionally, if you're facing a bullet and a bullet hits you in the face, not in my face, it's in my face, I can't see. But if it hits you in the face, then it will occasionally block the damage. And you'll know it'll block the damage because your character will flash blue. Because you know I'm blue. Da-da-dee-ba-da-da. Blue, if I was green, I would die. Okay. Wow, I'm actually a lot stronger on this run than I kind of expected. Which is great, actually. It's a great way to start things off here. I think it's a good sign of things to come. Do I pick up that item, or... Yeah, I'm gonna pick up this item. I consider donating all my money to the donation machine. So Mom's Coin Purse gives you 4 pills, which you may or may not know what they do. Speed Up is great. Luck Up, we've seen before. Are You a Wizard makes it so that we shoot tears at 45-degree angles here, which can be good in certain circumstances, as I found. And Health Up is actually really good, too. Gives us a heart container. One thing I should note, though, is that, If you're at or below one red heart total, like we were just there, a health down pill, which do come into play, and they'll be very annoying in certain circumstances, believe you me. But a health down pill will act as a health up pill. Similarly, a bad trip pill that we saw earlier in the run that damages you if you're at one heart or below will act as a full health pill, which means that, even though it might seem counterintuitive, you sometimes want to hold on to a bad trip pill as long as you possibly can. Of course, full health won't replenish your spirit hearts or anything, it just fills up your red heart containers, so it wouldn't be as useful in our circumstance right now. This is Gertie, by the way. He's, Sorry if I kind of, like, talk... If I kind of just, like, do things without really talking about them. It's just force of habit at this point. I've played upwards of 300 hours of this game at this point, I think, so you can pardon me if I kind of do things just by second nature. But yeah, Gertie, he just shoots little spread shots like that and spawns enemies. And I'm not even sure what the hell he's supposed to be. I don't know if a Gertie is a real medical term, but he's gross, whatever he is. I don't know if he's like an abandoned fetus. That would fit in with the theme of this game. Little Chubby has appeared in the basement. That's another good item that will hopefully make use of at some point. Another HP upgrade there, and a deal with the devil, containing not a great item, but it's one that I'll take because we've never seen it before. Sister Maggie, friends till the end, creates a little red baby here that shoots fires tears, and I think those tears do a reasonable amount of damage depending on how far you are into the game. By the way, this game does track, oh believe you me, it tracks all the items you've collected over the course of your entire play history. So if you want 100% the game, you're going to need to pick up every single item, good, bad, or otherwise. This could be good, speed up, that is fine by me. And I'm actually going to, instead of fighting this room, use the stars card to teleport out right to our treasure room, which contains the black bean, toot untouched. Which is a little bit better than the bean, I think, because it doesn't take up your spacebar slot, for one thing. And basically what it does is if you get hit by an enemy like that, you will fart and poison them. So generally you want to avoid getting hit by enemies, but if you do, then at least you'll have that backup damage to rely on. That's a battery pickup right there. It recharges your spacebar item instantly, no matter how many charges it normally takes to fill it up. And we actually got pretty lucky here finding our boss room right off the bat in the Depths 1. The third chapter of the game, The Depths. And I'm going to put a bomb right here, actually, to blow up those two skulls. The skulls often pay out with good things. That time they didn't, it was just an enemy. And this is our super secret room. Like I said, it's close to the boss. This is Butt Penny. Ignoring the humorous name for now, it appeared in the lower right corner there. That's a trinket, and if you hold a control, then you can drop that if you want. Just like that. It's basically a passive item, pretty much all of them are passive items that you carry around and you can swap out for other trinkets whenever you need to. And they'll have certain different effects. Butt Penny here makes it so that whenever we pick up a penny on the ground, Monster 2, whenever we pick up a penny on the ground, we will fart. Not a poisonous fart like we've been seeing with the black bean and stuff, but just a fart that propels enemies away from us. So, I mean, it's not the greatest, it's pretty awful if I'm being completely blunt. Because how often are you going to find yourself picking up money while fighting enemies? There are certain enemies that, sure, you might find yourself in that circumstance, but not incredibly common. So Monster 2 here is kind of rough. You can bait him into doing this big laser beam attack, which is something you cannot block with infamy or shielded tears or anything. That'll just go straight through you, like butter. Like butter, Ronnie. Like butter. You can see me flashing blue there. That's infamy in action, blocking the tears that I'm taking stupidly on the chin. And there we go. Monster 2 actually has probably one of the highest HP counts of any boss in the game. Mom's Heals is a range upgrade. If you ever want to see your stats, by the way, you can check out just your pause menu here. That first one is speed, the little boot. The second one is shot speed, how fast your tears fly through the air. The next one, the sword, is damage, which ours is looking pretty good, if you ask me. That next one up there, the bow and arrow, is range. The other one, I think, what is that? No, I think that one is shot speed, the little ball with the lines behind it. I think the arrows, that is your tears stat, which is how fast you fire, like how many shots you fire per second, pretty much. And the last one down there, the clover, is luck, which we're actually looking pretty good on, I guess, with Luckfoot. And you can see all our items down there in the My Stuff. So, probably should have showed that off sooner than the second to last floor of this run, but better late than never, as I say. Oh my god, that's scary. I'd be terrified to be trapped in a chest like that. I am actually reasonably claustrophobic, which some of you may or may not know. Ooh, this is a rough room. Those guys suck you in. This is a rough room too, actually. I think I'm fast enough that I can just run by this for the most part. Or maybe not. A general better strategy is to try and like bait out the spikes like that. But, and our treasure room right off the bat actually is really good. I have to take out these butt munches before anything else, though. When I say butt munches, I mean it in the most mean, insulting, ignoramus kind of way possible, because these enemies, I hate them, man. They come in hordes in later floors, and it's like, oh my god, just kill me now. If you're not doing enough damage, those guys will take an arm and a leg to kill. Didn't really make sense. Peeper's Eye is, gives you a little thing that bounces around the screen here, and if you could see my face, you would see that one of my eyes was popped out now, which is rather grotesque, but, you know, sometimes you gotta break a few eggs to, make your eye pop out of your head. That probably didn't come out as intended. Wow, these guys are ganging up on me. Okay. There we go. Rooms like this are great if you want to get some consumable drops, especially if you have a lot of bombs like this, because you can bomb these skulls, and the skulls, depending on your luck stat, more than anything else, will pay out with enemies or black hearts or sometimes tarot cards. It's generally a pretty good time. I'm going to try one more here. Ooh, a playing card, which is the Two of Spades, doubles our keys, or gives us two keys to work with. That is an item I'll probably not be able to afford, so let's just give our last... Aw, man, we broke the donation machine! That'll happen on, It takes a random amount of money on every given run to break the donation machine for the remainder of the run like that. It can take one penny, it could take, like, hundreds. You never know, you just have to try. Just keep going until it breaks like that. And that's just to prevent you from kind of cheating the system, as it were. Like, if you got, like, an easy way to get infinite money in the game, which does happen. It's happened to me a few times. You can't just, like, use that to max out your donation machine on one really lucky run. Which is pretty good. Peeper's Eye actually kind of saved us there. Well, he didn't save us, but he did a reasonable amount of damage for us there. Hardest room in the game yet? No. These guys aren't so bad. They just follow the perimeter of the room, or the perimeter of whatever space they cling to, I guess. And that's actually pretty good. Ooh, greed. Okay. Well, this is one of those enemies I was talking about that Butt Penny could be useful against, I guess. Because there's always money lying around when you're fighting greed. Ew, listen to this. Ugh, man. Gotta love it. You just kind of get, like, jaded to those sounds and this, like, grossness level once you play enough of this game, I guess. Or you might just be jaded to it already via other means that I'll not talk about now because... Ew. What is this? Explosive diarrhea. Maybe I'll save that for the boss. If you've forgotten, which I don't know how you could, based on a name like Explosive Diarrhea. But it makes us fart out like five bombs, or poop out five bombs, I guess is the more appropriate terminology there. These guys can be pretty scary. They shoot up bullets in random directions when they land on top of you. And they always will land on top of you if you don't run out of the way, so make sure to move your ass. Oh, these guys are rough. Just gotta take them one at a time, though. One at a time, every single time. This is actually, like, this is an exceptional run for many reasons, but I think it's largely because we have a pretty good balance of good defense and good offense. Like, we've gotten a lot of damage upgrades, to be honest, and a lot of good damage upgrades, like Ceremonial Robes, the Pentagram, things like that. It's growth hormones at one point, I remember. But we've also gotten really good defensive upgrades, like Shielded Tears that saved our ass more times than I care to count. And Infamy as well, so looking pretty good. Two of Clubs, I'll just pop that right now because we're right in front of the boss anyway. I wish we could take both of these pills into our boss room, but alas, we cannot. This is it, guys. The fight versus Mom. This is the final battle of the game. This is the end of the LP already. And I didn't even get finished talking about the basics of the game. Man, I am a slow LP'er, I guess. When it comes to the commentaries, anyway. Okay. Gotta be careful of that foot, because whenever it comes down, it does one wholehearted damage. Be very careful. I'm hunting wabbits. And I guess I should be using Explosive Diarrhea. Like I said, it was... Oh, crap. I'm gonna blow myself out of the water! Okay, I'm one hit away from dead if Mom's foot lands on me. But she's so close to dead that I don't know. It's gonna be a close one. Come on, just hit her. Just hit her a few more times. There it is.
Was cornered. His mother, fueled with the desire to serve her god, was bearing down on Isaac. I will do as I'm told, my lord. I love you above all else, Isaac's mother repeated to herself. This was the end of the line for Isaac. His mother was far too strong for him. But just as he accepted his fate, God intervened, sending an angel down from above to stop his mother's hand. And just like that, it was over.
Make of that what you will. So that is the end of our first run of the Binding of Isaac here. And that won't be the final boss every time. Well, I guess that's kind of a bit of a spoiler, but we'll see it in due time in the next video, definitely. Yeah, so that is the mom fight. Probably, well, if you're not, it's not usually a hard fight. As you can see, it wasn't exceptionally hard there, but if you're not prepared for it, which I had pretty low HP given, it can be a little bit rough. I unlocked the womb, which is chapter 4. I unlocked the challenge number 20, the Pierce. We'll get into challenges later. The Harbingers are new bosses. The cube meat and ball bandages are new items. So hopefully we'll see some of that shenanigans on our next playthrough here. But for now, I think I'm set to call it a video. I'll pretty much be doing one run per video. And you can see now our win streak is at 1. And maybe next time we'll play as Lazarus over here, who we unlocked. Or Azazel. I forgot we unlocked her too. Her or him, I don't know what you want to call Azazel. It's kind of like a demon. Has negative 1 HP there, you can see. That's kind of... And, yeah. So hopefully you guys like this. I don't know how it's going to go over. This is kind of different from anything I've ever done on this channel, but hopefully it should be interesting. I'm in for the long haul if you guys are, and I think that's like the third time I've said that expression on this video, so that's probably my sign to call it quits. So thanks everyone for watching. This is ArgonMatrix, signing out. Thank you and good night.